Greetings, members, one and all, of the Salivation Nation. Could this be what will end stagnant gold and silver prices? Let's explore. Yes, indeed. That is the question. We're kind of frustrated, most of us here, with these prices. Well, that is if you are one that believes that gold and silver should be up higher than they are now, especially considering what's going on in the world. They've been a bit stagnant. But, you know, analysts have been talking about that we may see a period of time during the first part of this year, maybe through the first quarter into the first half of the year, where we may see lower gold and silver prices. In fact, some technical analysts like Chris Vermeulen predict as such that we will see prices of gold fall below $1,700 and of gold fall there and silver to fall into $23-$24. We'll see. But I believe that there's things that can be happening in the news that could change that. But let's take a look at what's going on here today with the markets as we see these prices here before our very eyes, all in the red. Gold has fallen as yields tick up and the dollar firms, according to CNBC. That's with the Dow climbing 199 points in late day rebound, led by stocks benefiting from reopening. So this reopening is starting to happen here. We could see some of the other headlines trending that some $1,400 stimulus checks went to people who didn't need them. That's very interesting to see. Obviously, those who are in death row don't need those $1,400 stimulus checks. That's for sure. Gold fell on Thursday as U.S. Treasury yields nudged up and the dollar hit a four-month high, denting the non-yielding metal's appeal. That's right, it doesn't yield anything except for beauty and as a hedge, as a stability, as that metal that has preserved our wealth for millennia. Spot gold fell 0.4% to $1,727.01 per ounce. U.S. gold futures settled down 0.5% to $1,725.10. The U.S. benchmark treasury yields were slightly up, increasing the opportunity cost of holding bullion. The dollar index gained 0.4%, having hit its highest level since November the 13th at 91.92 earlier in the session, making gold more expensive for other currency holders. You're seeing a big differential in government bond rates between the U.S. and other European countries, and that is causing increased flows into the greenback. And that is weighing on precious metals, says Kitco Metals senior analyst Jim Wyckoff. The momentum for gold is on the bearish side, so you're going to have to see prices rebound a little bit for the bulls to gain some confidence that some kind of upward sustainability can be achieved. And I believe that's going to happen later in the year, if not sooner. Gold's losses came despite sentiment in wider financial markets being weakened by a new round of coronavirus restrictions in the Eurozone. And silver fell $25.01 an ounce, having earlier fallen to a more than two-month low. I saw that happen live. $24.39 it got to. Silver should find support around the $24, $25 level and then rise modestly over the course of April, following a likely move up in gold and on investor hopes for a stronger industrial fabrication demand metal, said Jeffrey Christian, managing partner at CPM Group. And we saw platinum and palladium also fall as well. There could be more platinum supply from South Africa this year. Rising auto demand will likely spur shortfalls in coming years, but that's taken into account of what's going on that we talked about in Russia, especially palladium. Will likely be severely undersupplied this year with prices as high as $3,000 conceivable, which is going to put pressure on platinum production because platinum will probably be used as a substitute for some of the retooling that will begin to take place if we see palladium move up. Let's take a look at these prices again as a slight shift here with a slight drop in palladium. It did get up to almost, well, just over $2,700. The high is over $2,800, but yes, with that mine closure, 20% of production affected. It's already a rare precious metal, much rarer than gold and rarer than platinum for sure. So we'll see how that plays out. I believe the platinum group metals, I'm bullish for all three of them actually at this point. Was not so much for palladium until we heard that news about the flooding of that mine. But there's still studies that we'll find out in April to where that is to see how soon they can reconstitute that mine. So what is this one thing that will, that could end these stagnant gold and silver prices? It may not be some of the stuff that was talked about in the article here, but this other thing that is breaking news now. Massive ship blocking the Suez Canal brings billions of dollars in trade to a standstill. With already short supply chains, we've got another problem here with this ship. And some are wondering what's going on here with it, according to its GPS. This is a very rare instance of a way this thing has locked into that massive container ship. The Ever Given has been stuck in the Suez Canal for 3 days, which has halted billions of dollars in trade as vessels pile up at both ends of the waterway. More than 150 ships are waiting to pass through the 120-mile canal, according to estimates from research firm StoneX. Images captured from vessel tracker marine traffic show the extent of the buildup, and there it is. So you can see all of these ships are just hanging out there. The canal handles around 12% of seaborne trade, making it an essential point of passage. Each day, a blockage disrupts more than $9 billion worth of goods, according to the Associated Press, citing estimates from Lloyd's List. Research from StoneX noted that 24 of the vessels are carrying crude, 15 are refined product tankers, and 16 are liquefied natural gas, liquefied petroleum, gas product carriers. The ships waiting to pass through the canal, alternate options are limited. As delays continue, shippers will have to broach the unpalatable decision to whether to make a U-turn and head for the Cape of Good Hope, that's around the Horn of Africa, or wait it out until the in the Red Sea and the Mediterranean, commodity data company Kipler said in a note to clients. Rerouting significantly increases a ship's length, which translates to higher cost. Sailing from the Suez Canal to Amsterdam takes just over 13 days when traveling at 12 knots, compared to 41 days of traveling around the Cape of Good Hope on the southern tip of Africa. The event highlights the relatively fragility of the on-water trading system, particularly for those flows in which the Suez Canal transits make up a higher percentage of total volumes moved, the firm added. The ship became horizontally wedged in the waterway following heavy winds. Multiple tugboats were sent to the scene, and a team from Smith Salvage has been called to assist. You know, it's very interesting to see this occur in that way. Yes, winds could have played a part, but you know, it makes you kind of wonder, a ship that size, for the winds to have that effect of it there, it's almost as likely as the wind blowing over our esteemed installed present in the United States 3 times trying to get up on Air Force One. Dredging operations to assist refloating the vessel continue. In addition to the dredgers already on site, a specialized suction dredger has arrived at the location. And so the enormous cargo carrier is more than 1,300 feet long and about 193 feet wide. It weighs more than 200,000 tons. One end of the ship was wedged onto one side of the canal and the other stretched nearly to the other bank. Nearly 19,000 ships passed through the canal during 2020 for an average of 51.5 per day, according to the Suez Canal Authority. Ship was sailing from China to Rotterdam when it ran aground. This goes to show you that something like that can occur and makes you wonder if there is what kind of sabotage could take place and give ideas for that kind of event. If this wasn't a sabotage case, which I'm not saying it necessarily is, but I wouldn't rule it out at this point. While it remains premature to assess full impacts arising from the accident, the channel seeks to indicate that and within the near term, the blockage is likely to add to industry supply chains, which are already hampered by ongoing supply chain bottlenecks. And we'll see. It's going to be very interesting to see. I hear This image showing shipping traffic halted due to the ever given container ship Rungamunk, top left of the canal. You can see there in this image, look at that. There's where the ship is stuck. And there's all the ships waiting to get in there. Pretty amazing. Something else. And what does that have to do? Well, oil prices go up, and it creates an economic hardship because of supply chains. That could have an effect on gold and silver in the short term, where we could see those prices move out of the stagnancy sooner rather than later. And, you know, things like this, you know, though I would not call this a black swan event, it certainly is an event that could have an effect on the economy. It depends if they can get it out. If they can't get the ship out of there with the high tide coming within 3 days, then we're talking several weeks of trying to dig this thing out. So this is something that could have an effect and have a where the prices could go up because of this. We'll find out. You know, and again, I'm open to all possibilities here as to where this thing is going to go, but it's a highly unusual situation in such a way that is been stuck there. But it had to be some pretty strong winds. It's a little bit fishy how this has played out, but I'm just asking the questions. I'm not necessarily making an accusation or theorizing anything beyond what we are seeing here. We'll find out, but obviously they are at work trying to free the ship right now. Nonetheless, that's what gold and silver are for, to protect us in these particular times where we're not sure exactly what's going to happen in terms of our economic situation, which is pretty fragile at the moment. I would think that's a safe bet, considering that supply chains are still under strain right now in all areas, especially now really with gold and silver that's going on. Still getting difficulty getting orders fulfilled, but things are starting to normalize in that area as well too, where people are starting to see their orders come in. I've got one that's well over a month old, about 5 weeks old, that has been just given a shipping notice now. And so we're starting to see some things start to make progress with some of these orders that we've been at, and for other things too. But I did hear on the news today that there is some supply chain issues with tissue paper. I kid you not, toilet paper. So it'll be very interesting to see how that is going to play out. And we just had a breaking news headline here. Fed says banks will have to wait until June 30th to start issuing buybacks and bigger dividends. A lot of different things that can have an effect on the news or on the prices for gold and silver. What will the markets, how will they react to that? I don't know. So many different things here and there that can play a role. And the things that we don't think necessarily would, could. And that is the story here in the news as of this day here on the 25th of March, 2021. Let me know your thoughts in the comment section below. Would like to extend a multitude of gratitude to you all for taking the time to watch and to hit that notification bell so that you can be apprised of the latest video that makes its way from this channel. And I want to encourage you to please rate, share, comment, and subscribe.